You're listening to the Tom Hartman Program.
And welcome back. Tom Hartman here with you. And on the line with us is Abraham Bolden, Sr., the first African-American Secret Service agent assigned to the presidential detail, the author of The Echo from Dealey Plaza. The website is echofromdealeyplaza.net. And Mr. Bolden, welcome to the program.
Thank you very much, Tom, and thanks for inviting me.
It is an honor and a privilege to speak with you, sir. You were, if you could tell your story to our audience.
Yes, well, I grew up in East St. Louis, Illinois, young man, and I went to Lincoln High School. And after I graduated from Lincoln University in Jefferson City, Missouri, I sought employment in the police line. Now, I became a Pinkerton National Detective Agent, and from there I went into the Illinois State Police. And after being on the Illinois State Police for around 4 years, I became a United States Secret Service agent. Now, in being a United States Secret Service agent, I was transferred here to Chicago, Illinois. We had a hot election going on at the time I was appointed a Secret Service agent under Eisenhower in 1960. We had Nixon and Kennedy battling toe-to-toe. And, of course, everyone knows, according to history, that Kennedy came out on top. Well, I was transferred to Chicago after having served on the state police in Peoria, Illinois. Now, President Kennedy, being a newly elected young president, energetic president, who had been very impressive in his debates with Nixon concerning especially civil rights issues. Now, the president was coming to Chicago on April the 28th of 1961 in order to thank Mayor Daley at a big banquet that they were having at McCormick Place in order to thank Mayor Daley for turning out the vote. Mm-hmm. I think he won Cook County by somewhere like 8,000 votes or so. Uh-huh. And Mayor Daley and his machine was directly responsible for his taking of Cook County, which put him over the electoral vote. Mm-hmm. So now, when the president was coming to Chicago, as I said, to thank Mayor Daley, and at me being a new agent in the Secret Service office assigned to Chicago, having been appointed in Chicago October the 30th of 1960 under President Eisenhower, I was assigned to the lower level of Wacker Drive in front of a bathroom, in front of a toilet that was set aside for the president to use. Now, normally they would have had a uniformed policeman at that position, but they moved the uniformed policeman at that position and moved me downstairs at the position in front of the washroom. And I think that I was very disappointed, I recall, because I wanted to see the president so bad because I thought so much of him and his policies and programs that he had promised the American people. He was very well liked in the so-called black neighborhoods at that time, and I think that he got a tremendous lift and vote from the political structure here that was being run largely by Negro politicians in Chicago here. Anyway, on April 28th of 1961, the president arrived a little late at McCormick Place, and I was stationed downstairs, as I say, in front of this washroom, and I heard the motorcade pull up at around 8:30. The president was due at 8 o'clock, but the motorcade was late. So when the motorcade pulled up, I saw the cameras flashing upstairs and the newspaper photographers and everybody. They were scampering about and moving about and stumbling over each other, all trying to get in the best position to get a shot at the president. And I was straining my neck trying to look up those two flights of stairs so that I could at least get a vision of President Kennedy. Well, I got a big surprise that night because as I looked up about the second time, straining my neck, the president was coming down the steps. Hmm. The first thing that he wanted to do was use the washroom. So I was in the best position in the whole house.
Yeah.
As the president approached me with Mayor Daley and all of the high dignitaries of the Democratic Party of Cook County. So it really worked to an advantage to me. But more surprising than anything else was the fact that as the president, before he entered the washroom, he stopped right in front of me. Well, I had no idea what was on his mind, so I kind of stepped to the side, and the president stepped to the side and kept facing me. So he looked at me and asked me, he said, "Are you a Secret Service agent or are you one of Mayor Daley's finest?" And I responded, "I'm a Secret Service agent, Mr. President." And one of the agents who had accompanied the president downstairs told him my name, said, "That's Abraham Boland. He's stationed here in Chicago." And the president looked me right in the eye and he smiled. He said, "Mr. Boland." And that's what he called me. He said, "Mr. Boland, has there ever been a Negro on the White House detail, security detail of the Secret Service?" And I looked at him. I was surprised that he asked me that. I said, "Not to my knowledge, Mr. President." And he looked me straight in the eye, and he looked around. He smiled at Mayor Daley and William Dawson, who was congressman from the south side of Chicago, a very powerful politician. They smiled, and he looked me in the eye and said, "Would you like to be the first?" I said, "Yes, sir, Mr. President." I almost fell backwards. And so he said, "I'll be looking forward to seeing you in Washington, D.C. soon." And so I came home. You know, I was very enthused. It was a remarkable thing that had just happened to me. I never in a thousand years, when I was watching a president on television doing his debate with Richard Nixon, I never thought that I would be standing face to face with the president of the United States, especially. It was a great honor for me to have had that conversation. If it had stopped at that, that would have been a great accomplishment for me. But to be invited to Washington, D.C., to become the first African-American to be assigned to the White House Secret Service detail was like adding icing on the cake. This was really something that I had never expected. Well, on June the 6th of 1961, I reported to Washington, D.C., and became the first African-American assigned to the White House detail. Now, immediately after assuming a position on the White House detail, I noticed that that there was a laxity around the president. There were a lot of misconduct things going on among the Secret Service agents. Many of them would leave the White House during the lunch period, and they would go to different bars and have martinis, and they would come back in no condition to protect the president of the United States. And I noticed that this was a real problem because the supervisors were doing nothing about it. And the agents, they seemed to me to be overconfident. And when I brought this up to the chief of the Secret Service, he says, "Well, it seems like, you know, you're a new agent and blah, blah, blah." He made excuses for him instead of paying me any real attention. Now, that was James Rowley, the chief of the United States Secret Service detail.
If I may, we're talking with Abraham Boland Sr., the first African-American Secret Service agent assigned to the presidential detail, who got himself caught up in something really nasty after he was assigned to be the first African-American to serve the president. We'll continue with this in just a second. The Echo from Dealey Plaza is the book. EchoFromDealeyPlaza.net, the website. Stick around. And Mr. Boland, please hold on the line.
This is the Tom Hartman Program.
We'll be back with more of Abraham Boland, and eventually Lamar Waldron is going to join us as well. We'll be right back. So, Mr. Boland, or Agent Boland, what's the appropriate title, sir?
Yes, Mr. Boland is
okay. Fine. So, Mr. Boland, you were talking about how the Secret Service reacted to your pointing out that some of these agents, and we're going to have to take another one of these short breaks like this in about 4.5 minutes, just as an FYI, and then Lamar will join us as well. Did that estrange you from the other Secret Service agents?
Yes, it did, because I became a constant complainer about some of the conduct that they were having, especially in Hyannisport, Massachusetts, when Kennedy went there for the 4th of July vacation. Mm-hmm. There was just too much drinking. Agents were reporting to the Kennedy compound in no condition whatsoever to go at the President of the United States. I found that there was a terrible amount of racism within the Secret Service. But the most astonishing thing to me was the fact that they were dead set against President Kennedy and his policies, and they had let that fact infiltrate their thinking as to their duties as a Secret Service agent. Hmm. In other words, what I'm saying is that they had a personal dislike for the president, calling him such names as an N lover and speaking very disparagingly about the First Lady and much of the conduct of the president. Hmm. Now, I thought that was horrible because we had a responsibility to protect the president and not to oversee his conduct. And so now I was personally called, as I said several times, the N word, and I complained to my supervisor concerning the actions of the agents who were drinking and who were bringing in prostitutes to the hotel room where we were living, a little cottage, which was a little place just off from Hyannisport, Massachusetts. Now, when I came back to Washington, D.C., came back to Washington, D.C. on July the 5th, after the 4th of July holiday, I went straight into the chief of the United States Secret Service office, Ulysses S. Bauman. And I told Mr. Bauman that, as a fact, that the president, if anyone should take a shot at the president or try to harm the president, he would be in serious trouble because his Secret Service agents that surrounded him were very racist and they were against his policies. And I had heard them with my own two eyes, ears make the statement that if a one should try to harm the president, that they would stand down, that they would not protect the president because he should get what's coming to him. Now, I thought under the circumstances that this was such a horrendous statement that was made by one of the supervisors, Harvey Henderson of the Secret Service, that it should be brought directly to the attention of the chief of the United States Secret Service, which I did. Now, them having that attitude, the agents surrounding the president having that attitude, I asked to be relieved of my duties on the detail and came back to Chicago, Illinois, where I became a field agent again. But
okay. Let's pick up the story in just a second. We have to bounce out for just a second here. We're talking with Abraham Bolden, Sr., the first African-American Secret Service agent assigned to the presidential detail. He's the author of The Echo from Dealey Plaza. The website is echofromdealeyplaza.net. And I believe Lamar Waldron is going to join us in just a moment, too. We'll be right back. Past the hour. Welcome back. We're talking with Abraham Bolden, the first African-American Secret Service officer to protect the President of the United States. He was assigned at John Kennedy's request to President Kennedy back in 1961 and or thereabouts. Correct me if I'm wrong, sir. And you were telling us how the agents, particularly in around Hyannis, were racist. They were calling you the N-word. They said that if somebody tried to attack the president, they would stand down because he was an N-word lover, and therefore they thought that he would just be getting what he deserved. You brought this to the head of the Secret Service, and that's where we stopped. You want to finish the story?
Yes. When I came back to Chicago, whenever anyone from Washington, D.C., any official, high official, would come through Chicago and that there were many occasions, especially Inspector Kelly, whose jurisdiction covered the Chicago office. I explained to him what had happened and the attitude of the agents who were surrounding the president, that they would let the president be assassinated. Now, no one really wanted to pay me any attention here in Chicago. I brought it to the attention of my supervisors here in Chicago. And when President Kennedy came to Chicago in March of 1963, I noticed that the same conduct was endemic within the agents of the United States Secret Service who came from Washington, D.C. with the president. I understood from conversations that I overheard that they had been down on Rush Street. They were drinking all night, and they were in such a condition that they could not have possibly protected the president, because at a meeting that we had that were discussing the visit to Chicago in March of 1963, many of the agents were falling asleep. They were dozing off even during the meeting when we were discussing his protection. Now, in the meantime, we had serious threats against the president's life. We had a threat that had developed in different locations. The president was to come to Chicago again for, I believe, was the Army Air Force football game. He was due to come here on November the 2nd of 1963. Well, there was a lot of commotion because we had heard that there were men who had come to Chicago, Cubans, who were controlled by two European men who had lived in a rooming house just off of North Avenue and the Kennedy Expressway. They were in a rooming house, and the lady went into their room, and she saw, I don't know what were the circumstances that she saw them, but she saw high-powered rifles equipped with sights, and she also saw the itinerary. The motorcade, rather, the president was marked on one of the newspapers. So she put two and two together and notified the FBI. Well, the FBI, on November the 1st of 1963, called the Secret Service, and the Secret Service began an investigation into this. In the meantime, the agents who were investigating this and tried to detain and follow those suspects, they lost them. They blew the investigations. And now I believe that that was the reason that President Kennedy had to postpone his trip, because the fact that we had lost those.
Because there was a credible threat of an assassination. We just have about
three. Very credible threat.
We just have about 2.5 minutes left, and I'd like to get. I want to get to the end of the story. You tried to tell the Warren Commission that there had been a credible threat against the president in Chicago after the president was assassinated, and that led to your going to prison. Can you tell us how that happened?
Yes, that's right. Now, what happened was that we had an investigation here. We had an undercover agent within a group, and he heard one of the leaders of the group say that the president was about to be assassinated. Well, when the actual assassination happened, and I saw them gathering up the files and changing dates on the in the file, and heard Mr. Martineau, who was the special agent in charge, changing dates and retyping files and things like that, I knew that there was a cover-up going on. And I knew that the Warren Commission was not getting this information, because none of these characters who had foreknowledge that the president was going to be assassinated were being called before the Warren Commission. And so now I thought it was a horrendous act that the agency was doing, and I thought that I owed it to the American people to try to get before the Warren Commission and clarify much of the information that we had about the assassins here in Chicago and arrests that we had made and information that we had obtained. However, when I went to Washington, D.C. on May the 17th of 1964, they brought me back, the United States Secret Service brought me back, told me that there was an investigation going on back in Chicago, a counterfeit investigation that I was needed for. Now, I had tried to contact J. Lee Rankin, who was the general counsel for the Warren Commission, and there was another agent with me, and I believed that I was being followed, and that telephone the call that I tried to make to J. Lee Rankin to the White House had actually been recorded or something had happened. But anyway, early the next morning, the supervisors and the chief of the United States Secret Service took me to Dulles Airport and brought me back to Chicago, Illinois, where I was charged with a crime. I was charged with soliciting a bribe from two counterfeiters, both of whom I had arrested.
Amazing. Mr. Bolden, can you stay with us for the rest of the hour, sir?
Yes, I can.
Great. We have to take a break for the news here at the bottom of the hour. It's about a five-minute break. We will be back with Abraham Bolden Sr., and then a little later on, Lamar Waldron is going to join us as well. Echo from DealeyPlaza.net is the website.
You're listening to the Tom Hartman Program. Call 866-987-THOM.
And Lamar's website is thehiddenhistoryofthejfkassassination.com. We're going to have Agent Bolden, Mr. Bolden, finish his story right after the news. Welcome back. Tom Hartman here with you. And Danielle, for some reason, when I click on Abraham Bolden's line, it doesn't. Oh, there it goes. Okay.
I'm here. Working.
Ah, Mr. Bolden, welcome back. Yeah. So you, if I can recap very quickly, and please correct me if I get any of these details wrong. You were a Secret Service agent. You were in Chicago. President Kennedy came through. He met you where you were assigned to guard a washroom that he would use. He invited you to come to Washington, D.C. and be the first African-American Secret Service officer or agent as a member of the presidential security detail. You found that there was extraordinary racism and a lot of drunkenness and carousing with prostitutes and whatnot among that group, particularly in Massachusetts or when they went to Hyannis, and that they disliked Mr. Kennedy, President Kennedy. They called him an N-word lover. They said that if somebody were to shoot him, he would simply be getting what he deserved. You reported this to the head of the Secret Service, which did not earn any friendship from them. So you ultimately said, just send me back to Chicago. You were back in Chicago, and you discovered, it was known to everybody in the Secret Service, apparently, that there was a real credible threat with two guys with high-powered rifles who were going to shoot the president's motorcade on the 2nd of November of 1963. This is just a few weeks before he was assassinated in Dallas. After he was assassinated, the head of the Chicago Secret Service office and some of these other officers were retyping these reports and changing the dates and obscuring the facts. You wanted to get the information to the Warren Commission. You went to Washington, D.C. to do that, and they sent you back to Chicago where you were arrested for taking a bribe from two guys that you had arrested previously, two counterfeiters. Are we up to speed so far?
You're absolutely right.
Okay.
You're absolutely
so,
right.
So it turns out that you were set up for this arrest. You did not take a bribe from these men. Why did they set you up? Why did you spend the next, I believe it was 7 years in prison? And what, you know, tell us the rest of the story here.
Well, the reason that was given by Inspector McCann, who accompanied me back to Chicago on the flight, TWA flight, he said that I was not a team player and that the members of the Secret Service, the echelon, were not going to stand by and see me wreck their careers. This is what he told me during the conversation that I had with him. So I have no question that this whole thing was formulated because of my intent on going before the Warren Commission. Now, one of the persons who testified in my trial, a guy named Joseph Spagnoli, was a runner and really a flunky for Sam DiStefano. Now, Spagnoli subsequently, after I was convicted in January of 1965, Spagnoli confessed that he received information from the U.S. Secret Service and the U.S. Attorney General's office that as to what to say in my trial. And he admitted that he had perjured himself, and he also produced copies. Now, the reason he said that he had done that is because that the Secret Service and the U.S. Attorney Richard Seitz had solicited him to do that. Now, this other person who testified against me was Frank Jones. He was going down on my testimony for the third time. He would have been convicted on a third-time felony, which carried a life imprisonment sentence automatic in the state of Illinois. Now, these are the two people that testified in my trial. Not only that, we had information that, as I say, an undercover agent who was very reliable and who had heard one of the conspirators here in Chicago said that the president was about to be assassinated. Now, that conversation took place about 2 weeks before the actual assassination. Now, so what that brings us to is this, is that we had forehand knowledge that the president was about to be assassinated. We knew the reason that was given that the president was going to be assassinated. And the reason that was given by this Cuban exile was the fact that LBJ would be more agreeable for the Cubans to go back in and try to take Cuba, and that they had finally gotten the money. The Jews had put up money in order to finance the going back into Cuba and taking over Cuba by the mob. So the mob had a connection, had a very serious connection with the assassination of President John F. Kennedy. So now what they did with me, the judge, after the judge had told the jury to find me guilty in one trial and then listen to the second trial and expel me out of the courtroom, they sent me to a Springfield Medical Center for Federal Prisoners. Now, they sent me there with the intent of somewhere along the line of declaring me insane. I knew that up front, and I was prepared for it. And so on July the 6th of 1967, they came and got me out of the camp, which I was assigned to, took me over to the psychiatric ward and tried to declare me insane. They kept me there. They forced me to take psychotropic drugs and tried to their best to see that I never come out of that penitentiary. Now, the psychiatrist told me that when he interviewed me, that once that I came out of 21 East, which was the psychology division of Springfield Medical Center, that I wouldn't even know my name. But the thing about it is I defeated it. I defeated the medication with God's help, and I came through it, and I'm able to talk with you today as I did back in 2009, where we had a nice conversation, Tom, and I appreciate you inviting me on the show again.
Yeah. Well, thank you, sir. And so you were set up. Let me bring Lamar Waldron in here, if I may. Lamar, are you with us?
Yeah.
Lamar,
right,
you and I have had much more interaction with Mr. Bolden and helped, you know, write the story of how he was falsely accused and convicted and sent off to prison, basically to shut down the investigation into who killed Jack Kennedy. Do I have that right?
That's exactly right, Tom.
So you want to just make a brief point or ask, do you have a question for Mr. Bolden that might illuminate this?
Well, I think one important point to make is Mr. Bolden has told you about the attempt to kill JFK in Chicago. That was 3 weeks before Dallas. And JFK, they didn't just cancel the motorcade at the last minute. It was a very important motorcade. They had to cancel the entire trip. And what I was able to do, you and I working together, and was to build on the work of the House Select Committee on Assassinations, who in the late 70s investigated a lot of this material. And we were able to take that material and do a lot of additional investigation to confirm not only did that occur, I mean, I even spoke to JFK's press secretary, Pierre Salinger, who told me they had to issue two different phony excuses in the space of 45 minutes to explain why JFK canceled that Chicago trip at the very last minute without telling the public it was due to an assassination attempt. Not only did that happen in Chicago, but in Tampa, Florida, you and I also discovered by going through all of these old newspaper files that I was able to follow up with the Tampa chief of police, that 4 days before Dallas, the same thing had almost happened in Tampa, Florida. Only JFK couldn't cancel that motorcade at the last minute for reasons I'll explain later. So we had to go through with that motorcade. So there were two very dangerous attempts to assassinate JFK in the weeks before Dallas. John and Robert Kennedy themselves, in addition to all the law enforcement, kept those out of the press. So you can start to see this is why the Secret Service, one big reason the Secret Service was so worried about Mr. Bolden telling this to the Warren Commission, because the Warren Commission was not told about those two attempts. They got a little information informally through newspaper accounts about the Chicago attempt, because a little bit did appear later.
Mr. Bolden, did you approach the Secret Service and say, I have information, or did they come to you and say, the Warren Commission, or did they come to you and say, can you tell us something?
No, I tried to contact the Warren Commission. Mm-hmm. Now, I don't think it was a surprise to anybody because they knew how I had been complaining. And when they were retyping these reports and redictating them and changing dates, I think that I made a mistake in letting them know that I knew what was going on. Uh-huh. And so now that was a horrible mistake that I made. So once that I did that, they knew that by me being an inside man, an agent within the office, that what I would say would have a whole lot more credibility than just the average researcher, because I was actually there. I could tell a commission dates and times that these things were going on, who received the files, who retyped them, and how they were delivered to Washington, D.C., to Assistant Director Paul J. Paterny. So I had a lot of information concerning this, and not only that, how it was connected here in Chicago, how the mob was connected in Chicago through Sam DeStefano and through Richard Kane, who had been one of the sheriffs here in Chicago.
And through the mob.
Yeah. All mashed together here in Chicago, and that's why they had to cover a lot of this up.
Yeah. Mr. Bolden, we have to take another one of those very short breaks. We'll be right back with Abraham Bolden Sr. and Lamar Wall.
You're listening to the Tom Hartman Program. Visit TomHartman.com for audio and video archives.
Mr. Bolden's book is Echo from Dealey Plaza, the website echofromdealeyplaza.net. Lamar's book is The Hidden History of the JFK Assassination, and that's the website.com. So, Mr. Bolden, when you contacted the Warren Commission, did they welcome you coming to D.C., or did you go to D.C. sort of to knock on their door?
Never had a chance to contact the Warren Commission, because when I made the telephone call, I had dialed a White House number. I don't recall the number right now, but I was in a telephone booth. The agent was standing in a telephone booth next to mine. It was a tandem telephone booth, but I noticed that he wasn't dialing anything, and so I know that he was probably there to try to listen in on any conversation that I had. And when I mentioned the name J. Lee Rankin, and I noticed that this other agent was not talking to anybody, I hung up, because I just felt that he was standing in the booth to try to verify what I had in mind. Because I believe to my heart today that the Secret Service knew what I would do once that I got to Washington, D.C., and they were set for it, and they were already planning for my demise when I went to Washington, D.C. They couldn't set it up with me in Chicago because they know I would become aware of it. They had to wait until I was in Washington, D.C. for that weekend between May 15th and May 17th in order to get this thing all set up.
So Tom,
if I could add something else here.
Certainly, Lamar.
It was even worse for the Secret Service than what has been explained so far. One reason the Secret Service, another reason, they were so worried that Mr. Bolden would not only tell the Warren Commission about the Chicago and Tampa attempts that were being completely hidden from the Warren Commission, but the night before JFK was shot in Dallas, I should actually say the morning JFK was shot in Dallas, there were, I believe it was between 6 and 9 Secret Service agents were in a sleazy after-hours club in Fort Worth. This is JFK's presidential protection detail, drinking high-alcohol drinks in a sleazy coffee shop that was serving these high-alcohol drinks served by scantily clad women. These were JFK's Secret Service agents who were supposed to protect him. They were in that club, some of them, till 2, 3, 4, even 5 a.m., before they had to report for duty at 8 a.m., and the public did not know that at the time. If the public knew that a lot of these Secret Service agents, many of whom you've seen on TV during this past 50th anniversary, were out drinking in a sleazy club owned by one of Jack Ruby's friends until, like, say, one didn't leave that club until 5 a.m., had to report to protect JFK 3 hours later, that would have been...
It would have been bad news. Mr. Bolden, was that kind of conduct that Lamar just described in Dallas or in Fort Worth, was that consistent with the kind of conduct of the Secret Service officers that you saw or agents that you saw in Massachusetts who were protecting the president?
Absolutely consistent. Yes, it was. As a matter of fact, as I said, in March of 1963, when the president was coming to Chicago, the same type of conduct happened here in Chicago. And so by the agents who were to accompany the president. Now, this was in March of 1963. And so I complained about it then. And as I said, agents who were to protect the president, who had come here from Washington, D.C., were going to sleep in a meeting when we were discussing the protective assignment.
Amazing.
They were actually going to sleep and bragging about it.
Because they'd been up all night drinking. We'll be right back. Abraham Bolden, Sr. and Lamar Walters. Welcome back. We are witnesses to an extraordinary moment in history. Abraham Bolden, the first African-American Secret Service agent assigned to the presidential detail by Jack Kennedy himself, by President Kennedy, and who served the president, is on the line with us telling the story of how he got set up, because he tried to tell the story of an assassination attempt against the president just a few weeks before the president was actually shot. And Mr. Bolden, before Lamar and you wrap this thing up, this is, you know, maybe way off base, but do you think it's possible that in today's Secret Service there are agents who dislike the fact that they are serving and protecting an African-American president?
I have no doubt that there are. There are, and as you can see from some of the reports that we have received recently, just as recently as last year, the type of a conduct that I complained about all the way back in 1961 is still going on, as displayed in Colombia when the President Obama went to Colombia. The same type of conduct, the consorting with prostitutes and leaving their posts of duties and heavy drinking occurred there. And then I had other reports that when the president went on a vacation, President Obama, at Hannesport, Nantucket Sound down there, is that Secret Service agents were drunk again down there. So in my estimation, Tom, President Obama's in serious trouble so far as his security is concerned. And
wow,
something should be done about it. The American people should write their congressmen and see that the Secret Service have taken steps to rectify many of the errors of conduct that were going on around the president. And I'm not sure that those faults have been corrected.
Yeah, that's a pretty startling thing to think about. Lamar, there is an effort that you and I, you know, we wrote about this for back in 2009 for Huffington Post. We should take this piece and reprint it. I think we could get it republished fairly quickly to try to get Mr. Bolden a presidential pardon, because he was set up and the people who sent him to prison, you know, later admitted that they had lied and that he had, you know, basically it was trying to keep this information from the Warren Commission. How goes that?
Well, you're exactly right, Tom, and people can do two things if they'd like. They can go to the hidden history of the JFKassassination.com, and there is a link on that page. It's a very simple page. There's a link on that page that will take your listeners to the White House website, where I have established a petition calling on President Obama to grant both a presidential pardon and also to release all of the JFK assassination files, which according to NBC News may number up to a million pages. Also on that page, the hidden history of the JFKassassination.com, there is a link to that earlier Huffington Post piece that has a lot of detailed information. So if people want to tell their friends about Mr. Bolden's story, they don't even have to look at my book or his book. They can look at that link, and I will tonight update that story so we can get a more recent version. But so those two links are on that page as we speak.
Okay. And Mr. Bolden, your book, Echo from Dealey Plaza, and the website echofromdealeyplaza.net, when did your book come out, and how can people find it?
It came out in March of 2008. Mm-hmm. And now it's at the Amazon, it's at most of your bookstores, but if they would like an autographed copy, they can send me an email at a.bolden@sbcglobal.net, and the price is $15 plus $5 mailing fee.
Wow.
They can send it right to me, and I'll send them an autographed copy.
That's great. That's great. And the website is echofromdealeyplaza.net. Lamar, you want to wrap this up? We just have a minute or two.
One is, as Mr. Bolden has said, there have been all of these incidents in Columbia, in Miami. There was one at the Hay Adams Hotel in Washington where this heavy drinking and carousing, you know, because Mr. Bolden's information was never made really public back in 64 in a wide way, you know, these behaviors have gone on. There's an ongoing racial discrimination lawsuit. I mean, somebody at a Secret Service training facility, an agent, found a noose on his desk. This goes back to 2008. And so you have racial discrimination that's still in the Secret Service today that's being fought by agents. So again, this is why it's important to get this information out. And then, of course, last but not least, the mafia could not afford to have the information about their attempts to kill JFK in Chicago and Tampa exposed back in 1964. That is why a closest mob associate of Sam DiStefano named Richard Kane, who was the number two man in the Cook County, Chicago Sheriff's Department, who was also a made member of the mafia, who had been working closely with mobsters on plots, like going back to try to assassinate Fidel Castro for the CIA back when Richard Nixon was vice president. Richard Kane is his half-brother, told you and I. He had the motive, means, and opportunity to have framed Mr. Bolden, to have helped arrange for that perjured testimony. And so the mafia and the Chicago mobster by the name of Johnny Roselli later admitted his role in JFK's assassination, as did the godfather of Tampa, Santo Trafficante, as did the godfather who controlled Dallas and Texas and all of Louisiana, Carlos Marcello. So as I explained in the hidden history of the JFK assassination, it's really clear now who killed JFK, which CIA assets they used. Of course, all of those three mob bosses I just named had also worked on those CIA mafia plots under Vice President Richard Nixon that started back in '60.
We have to wrap it up. Lamar Waldron, thank you for being with us. Mr. Bolden, it's an honor to have you on, sir. Thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you for that. All right. Goodbye.
It's a true honor. Abraham Bolden, his website, echofromdealeyplaza.net. And, of course, the website for Lamar's book is The Hidden History of the JFK Assassination.